and I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
I love your voice.
You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are closer like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful.
Sing it to me.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am in, of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. When my life lay down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender it now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so
this morning.
Like I do. My name is Roger Glenn Singleton Oldham, and sing is short for singleton. It's not because I can sing. My dad was hopeful, but I'm a noun, never was a verb. I do love singing, though, and wasn't it a delight to sing these tremendous songs of praise to our faithful God. Well, I want to bring you greetings on behalf of Brother Randy Davis and the Tennessee Baptist Mission Board. And it's been a privilege to be working with him for this past year. He brought me on board during the COVID season because this has been a tough time. for pastors, for churches. How many of you all have gone through some tough times yourself during this COVID season? We've had more than 60 pastors and staff of Tennessee Baptist churches that have died as a direct result of complications from COVID since 2020 through 2021 so far. It's taken a tremendous toll, and many of our pastors are discouraged. Many of the metrics by which we evaluate how effective we are in reaching our community have had to change. I told one young pastor, a few months ago now, I said in the old way, the metrics were how many people gather, but now it's really how many people served. How many people are we able to serve through the ministries of our church? And those metrics have changed, and that's a good change because we want to be serving, but we also want to be gathering. And how good and pleasant it is when God's people gather together in the house of prayer at the time of worship. Well, again, I just want to say thank you for your contributions to the cooperative program of the Southern Baptist Convention and Tennessee Baptist Convention. Because of your gifts, more than 3,600 fully funded missionaries are serving the Lord overseas right now. And every time someone professes faith in Christ in more than 117 countries, you have had a direct part in that person's confession of faith because of your giving and your praying and your sending and even your going. So thank you for that. During the COVID year, I call 2020 the COVID year. I call this the year that we're trying to come out of COVID, but we're having a hard time getting out of it. Amen. But during the COVID year, here in Tennessee, 38 churches were planted. 38 churches were birthed during the COVID year. Amen. And that's because of your contributions through the cooperative program. In fact, I went back and did a little historical review of your church's gifts to the cooperative program. And since this church was established, more than $1,470,000 has been given by this congregation to reach the state, the nation, and the nations with the gospel. Wow. Amen. Thank you for that. And then, ever since this church was established, you know, this is a community of what, 2,000 people plus or minus. Are you aware that you have baptized more than 2,000 people in the history of this church? Now, that's not everybody that's living today, but that's people that over the years you have been reaching with the gospel. And I want to say thank you for your commitment to lift up Jesus Christ and Him alone, to lift up the cross, to bring people to see that there is a Savior and His name is Jesus. I want to invite you to open your Bibles with me. Luke chapter 18 is our text today. Luke chapter 18. Now I'm going to invite you to stand to your feet with me as we read together from God's Word. And as you're turning there, I would reiterate it's a great joy to be back with Brother Dean. I'll say a little bit more about when he came to lead us in revival. But also Brother Morgan Owen, Brother Mo, dear, dear friend, longtime member of the church there at Martin First Baptist, and I had the privilege of being his pastor and being the pastor of his wife and their three daughters during some of their formative years when they were growing and maturing and developing to the young women, godly young women that they have become. And then your pastor, I've known him all 23 years that he's been here. He and I were part of an accountability group, and we'd meet on Thursday mornings at 6 and have a time of prayer with several other pastors in the area. And what a delight it is to be in the pulpit where your pastor proclaims the word. He truly is a man after God's own heart, and I know you know that. Luke chapter 18, beginning in verse 1, then he, that is Jesus, spoke a parable to them that men ought always to pray and not lose heart. Listen again to that. Men, it's a generic word, men, women, people, followers of the Lord, ought always to pray and not lose heart. Saying, there was in a certain city a judge who did not fear God nor regard man. Now there was a widow in that city, and she came, and very literally, by the way, the word here came, literally is kept coming. Kept coming. And we'll see that in the text as we read through it. She kept coming to him saying, get justice for me from my adversary. And he would not for a while. But afterward he said within himself, though I do not fear God nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me. Do you hear the keep coming? She's just troubling me. Because she troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming, see it? She weary me. Then the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge said. And then this powerful insight. And shall not God, or shall God not avenge his own elect who cry out day and night to him, though he bears long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth? Would you bow your heads with me, please? I want to speak this morning on the subject of walking in hope daily. And Father, as we look at this parable this morning, it's the words of Jesus giving a teaching on the centrality of prayer in the life of the believer. And we hear his opening words that we ought always to pray and not lose heart. Father, I pray that you will use this time together, that we will hear with a new sense of hearing and understand with a new mind of perception, that though there may be times that it seems that you are far off, that you are the faithful God who ever lives, ever hears, ever cares. And as Brother Mo led us to sing a few moments ago, you are faithful. We love you today because you loved us first, and you sent your only begotten Son into the world to bear our sins to Calvary's cross, the sinless one becoming sin for us, that through him we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. The just one dying for the unjust, that we might be adopted into your family, and that the Spirit of your Son has come to dwell in our hearts, whereby we cry out, Abba, Father. Lord, we want to thank you for that marvelous gift of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. In his name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Well, real life is messy. Amen. It's just messy. Life is tough. My wife's mother, she's been our only living parent since 2002. She's 90, still lives on the farm by herself, been a widow for 30 years, until 3 years ago was still mowing her own grass and doing her own weed eating. She's a plucky, plucky woman. But she has told me on numerous occasions, getting old ain't for sissies. Life is messy. And everyone here has either struggled with an unrealized long-term hope, something that you've hoped for and it's just not happened yet, or you're about to enter a phase of life where it does seem that the Lord is very far away, and maybe he's far away from your hopes and dreams, and you wonder, does God really care? Does Jesus care? I remember, I'll mention in a few minutes about when my dad left my mother after 43 years of marriage. My mom would call me and say, son, where is God in all this? And her long-term hopes and dreams began to crumble in front of her. Life is tough, but we have a faithful God. Amen. So how many here have a situation in your life or with a family member that you just don't know how to pray for? Maybe it's a long-term illness or a wayward family member, or maybe just an unmet hope or unrealized dream. You want to have faith, but you've sort of resigned yourself. You know, dad is so far from God, he'll never change. Or I'm just so sick so much of the time, it saps my energy, my strength, it seems to rear its head again and again, and about the time I seem to be turning a corner, suddenly there's just a back slam again. Or maybe you have a daughter who's addicted to prescription drugs, or a son who drinks himself into oblivion every weekend. A sister who seemed attracted to a succession of losers, or a daughter whose standards are so high that you wonder if she'll ever find the husband that she longs for. There are a lot of things that we deal with in life. And just because we're followers of Jesus does not mean that we are immune from the fallenness of this world that we live in. So here's how sometimes we end up thinking. Well, I know God is all powerful, but there must be something wrong with me. Somehow he just doesn't seem to care about me the way he cares for others. We had a young lady that began to visit our church when I was pastor in Martin. And she said, you know, everybody in your church just seems to be so trouble-free and full of joy. I wish I could be full of joy and trouble-free the way they are. And I said, well, just tell me some of the people that you're thinking of. And she named three individuals. And when I told her the story of those three individuals' lives, she could not believe it because of the deep, deep valleys of despair and discouragement and death that they'd experienced in their lives, two of them having lost one an eight-month-old and one a four-year-old. She couldn't believe it. I just thought they were problem-free. No. We may be followers of Jesus, but we still live in a fallen world. And we begin to think, it just doesn't seem that God cares for me the way he cares for others. And so we sort of land here. I'll still go to church. It's where most of my friends are. I'll see them there. We'll get to fellowship. But maybe from time to time I'll hear something, give me something to cling to for a week or so. But at the end of the day, I really don't know that God cares for me or my situation enough to respond to my prayers. So my life, day in and day out, is marked by quiet desperation. By the way, you'd be amazed at how many people this scenario describes. I've had the privilege of preaching in a lot of churches. I was at Martin First Baptist for 21 years, and since then I've preached in hundreds of different churches, both here in the state, but also in other states, as I've had the privilege of traveling on your behalf to encourage pastors and to build relationships with many of our ethnic brothers and sisters who've come from other nations. Today, I mentioned a moment ago that during the COVID year, we planted 38 churches here in Tennessee. One of them was an Arabic-speaking church in Tennessee. Believers in Christ speaking another language, praising him today. That is worth an amen. And sometimes we just think, you know, God cares about those people more than he cares about me. But I want to give you a good word today. The parable today is written for us. So I want to step into our text by way of exposition. Exposition means just to sort of pull back the curtain and expose what is there in the verses that we just read. The parable opens with a very arresting statement. Men ought always to pray and not lose heart. Again, it's not men as opposed to women. It's men generically. It's talking about individuals, people. Those who know the Lord ought always to pray and not lose heart. Ought always to pray and not lose heart. It is likely that Jesus spoke many parables on prayer, for prayer was the atmosphere in which he walked. But we know of only two parables in prayer, on prayer, and both of them are found in the Gospel of Luke. Of all the parables Jesus gave, only two are on prayer, Luke 11:5-13, and the one we just read a moment ago from Luke 18:1-8. It's hugely significant that both parables stress the need for steadfast persistence. In Luke 11:5-13, the passage is that a man goes to his friend's house at midnight and asked for assistance to entertain some unexpected guests. But his friend said, man, it's midnight. My family's asleep. What are you doing banging on the door? Go back home. And the guy kept banging on the door. And finally his friend got up and gave him what he needed. And the guy went back to his house and entertained the unexpected guests. And the parable closes this way in Luke 11:13. This is a verse, if you want to memorize a Bible verse, this is one you ought to write down as a memory verse. Luke 11:13, Jesus said, if you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? That's a good word, isn't it? How much more? How much more? We give good gifts to our kids, don't we? We have 7 grandkids. The most recent was born 4 weeks and 3 days ago. I want to tell you, they're special. As soon as he was born and we knew that it was going to be a boy, I've already been to the store and bought him a toy for his first birthday. Because he's too young to play with it right now. How much, if we being evil, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him? And by the way, if you've been saved, you have the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit doesn't always have all of us. And so every day we need to come again and again and again and just say, Lord, I need the Holy Spirit. I need the Holy Spirit today to shelter over the things that I say, to shelter over the things that I think, to shelter over the things that I look at, to shelter over the places that I go, to shelter over the things that I do with my hands. I need the Holy Spirit. And here's the promise. How much more will the Father, the Heavenly Father, give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him? What a powerful word. The theme of the parable in Luke 11, don't lose hope. And what is the theme of the parable we just read in Luke chapter 18? Here's a judge who feared neither man nor God, yet because the widow persisted again and again, hear what Jesus said at the end of the parable, shall not God avenge His own elect? Oh, dear friend, the theme again is don't lose hope. Don't lose hope. Verse 1, we just read it. We ought always to pray and not lose heart. There are really only two options in the believer's life: growing deeper with God in prayer or losing hope. Those are the options. Growing deeper or losing hope. Growing deeper or losing hope. And where are we in that equation? You see, that's pretty much it. So why are our lives marked by such weakness and ineffectiveness? And by the way, you have a very healthy church here. I just want to share with you that. Healthy churches build healthy pastors that build healthy churches that build healthy pastors. Amen? Amen. And you all are well matched. You have poured into your pastor and wife and their family's lives, and they have in turn poured back into your lives. That is a healthy, you don't find that everywhere. And again, I've been to a lot of churches that are not healthy like you are. I've been to churches where there's been nobody who stirred the waters of baptism for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 years in a row. And something is going on there where there's a weakness, there's an ineffectiveness. There's not something that is marked by hopeful confidence and optimism that God is at work, that God is up to doing things in people's life. And so we begin to live these lives of quiet desperation. And so why are we not filled with joy and peace and confident hope that the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want? We're either growing deeper with God in prayer or we are losing hope. And Jesus spent long hours in prayer. In the nighttime, He sought both the lonely mountainside and the beautiful garden. And there He spent time alone with His Abba, His Father, the same Abba that when the Spirit of His Son comes to live in our hearts, Galatians 4:6 says that the Spirit of His Son in our hearts cries out, Abba, Father. And Abba there is the word of endearment. It's a word that literally means dad. Our Heavenly Father is our dad spiritually. And again, I mentioned that we have these grandkids, and we have twin grandsons. They're 9 right now, but back in 2015 when they were younger and I was a little bit younger, I had back surgery. And my daughter told them, now you can't run to Pops and just jump up at him the way that you've been doing, because as soon as they'd open the door to come to visit our house or I'd walk in their house, it's like, Pops, and they're coming storming down the hallway and they're jumping into my arms, and I got 2 of them and I'm trying to manage them. And so the very first time they came to see us after I had the surgery, sure enough, I had it in November, and they came to see us at Christmas. And sure enough, even though they had been rightly admonished by their mother, as soon as the door opened, they made a beeline yelling, Pops! And I had the foresight to drop down to one knee, and they just, vroom, jumped in my arms. And I want to tell you, that's the kind of relationship that your Heavenly Father wants to have with you. And if you don't have that relationship, it's not that he is aloof. You see, you're either growing deeper with God in prayer or you're losing heart. There it is. Jesus reflected such power and peace, as we noted from Luke 11, that the disciples pled with him, "Teach us to pray." And that first parable of Luke 11 on prayer is where Jesus is responding to their request when they said, "Teach us to pray." And they didn't say, "Teach us to evangelize," although that would have been a good thing to do, and we ought to evangelize. They didn't say, "Teach us to fellowship," and that's a good thing to do. We ought to fellowship. They didn't say, "Teach us to gather in small groups and in large congregations," although that's a good thing to do. They said, "We see in you," and in fact, this is the only thing the disciples ever asked Jesus to teach them. Now, he taught them a lot, but this is the one where they said, "Teach us to pray." Now, Jesus frequently paid tribute to widows, beginning with the widow who brought her mites. You remember that story, the two mites? And he's observing those coming to the treasury when she brought her small, little, tiny, not even a penny coin. Jesus said, "She has given more than all the rest." You remember that? The Bible's repeated reference to widows is proof enough that their fate was frequently pitiable. And in lifting up the widow in this parable, Jesus revealed his tenderness toward the oppressed and the downtrodden. She was a widow in the time when there was no safety net of protection such as we have today. There was no Social Security. Women didn't work outside of the home, so there was no pension. There was no Medicare. There was no Medicaid. She is bereft. She didn't have the money to hire an attorney. But the judge, on the other hand, had no time for the widow. But the widow accosted the judge wherever he went. Coming out of the temple on the Sabbath, there she was. "Get justice for me, for mine adversary." Walking to a friend's house for dinner, there she was. "Get justice for me, for my adversary." Taking a stroll with his wife to the market, there she was again. Always pleading, always beseeching, "Get justice for me, for mine adversary." Everywhere he went. I mean, she was so everywhere, the judge just grew weary. And finally he said, "All right already." And he provided justice from her adversary. In the story of the persistent widow, Jesus' teaching is in sharp focus. We too must pray and not grow weary when it seems our prayers are not heard in the time span that we prefer. Now, the parable follows immediately upon the connection of what preceded in chapter 17. In chapter 17, Jesus had been speaking to the fact that in the day of his second coming, things would be going on in the world as they were in the days of Noah and the days of Lot. And how many of you all sort of believe that we're almost there now? It was a time of darkness in Jewish history when Jesus gave this teaching. I mean, the Roman government was oppressing the Jewish people, and Jesus was crucified, but he was not crucified alone. There was a cross to the left, a cross to the right. It was a common form. I mean, all up and down the highways, there would be people crucified regularly by the Roman government because the people were oppressed. It was a dark time, and they wondered, where is God in all of this? And out of that setting, Jesus gave this parable, and then he said, it's going to even get worse before the second coming. And in fact, he closed the parable, when I come again, will I even find faith on the earth? So there's the setting. And also part of the setting is that in chapter 17, Jesus had pulled the disciples aside for a specific time of training and teaching and prayer and preparation. And so in chapter 18, verse 1, he's not talking to the masses. It's not like the Sermon on the Mount, the multitude. It's not even like in verse 9 in the same chapter where those who were self-righteous presented themselves and Jesus gave other teaching. Here in this opening part, he is talking to his followers. He is talking to his children. He is talking to his disciples. He is talking to those who already knew the Lord. And he says to them, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith? He's talking to the believers. When the Son of Man comes, will he find faith among his own church? And there's the context. As to the judge in the parable, none else but the incarnate Son could use a corrupt person like an unjust judge to represent the Heavenly Father. And he's not saying that God is an unjust judge. What he's saying is, if an unjust judge will finally grant relief to the widow, how much more the Heavenly Father? So here again, his words from chapter 11, if you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? And here again, the words from this chapter, men ought always to pray and not lose heart. That's an exposition of the text. I've just tried to sort of pull back the veil, as it were, and just sort of expose what we see in the text. But now I want to step into some application. Some application of the text. Though the word hope is not used in this passage, I've used the word hope. Don't lose heart is what Jesus said. I've sort of used don't lose heart, don't lose hope as synonyms. But I think that hope is in here because the substance of the thing hoped for is clearly embedded as the central theme of the parable. The widow kept coming and asking for what she hoped to see done, even when it seemed her pleading fell on deaf ears. And so I want to mention three passages of Scripture that deal with hope. And I want to tie them back to Luke 18 as we think together about not losing heart, but instead always praying. The first passage is Hebrews 11:1, and it's a description of hope. Hebrews 11:1 says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen." How many of y'all have ever learned that verse? You've seen it, you've read it. What in the world does it even mean? Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Well, the substance of things hoped for is where faith is believing something to be so when it is not so. Do you hear that? Tony Evans, many of you have heard of Pastor Tony Evans. He tweeted this in 2012, and I really love the tweet, so it's one of those that I sort of captured. He said, "Faith is acting like something is so, even when it is not so, in order that it might be so, simply because God said so." Now, I've taken that and changed it just a little bit to say it this way. Faith is believing. He said it's acting. It is acting because faith is always active. But faith is believing something is so even when it is not so, in order that it might be so because God has said so. Well, where did he say so? He said it right here. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So what is it in your life that you need God to do that you do not see and you don't even know if he hears you when you ask of him in prayer? Listen to the substance of things hoped for in these settings. To the unmarried woman, "Lord, I thank you for my husband, whether you be he or there be another." See, we really don't know the future. But whether you be her or there be another, "Lord, I thank you that you are my husband, but regardless that I find my contentment in you." To the man with a lingering disease, "Lord, I thank you for strength of life and length of days, choosing to live every day to the fullest, choosing to live until I die, not to die inwardly out of despair or despondency or prematurely out of discouragement or loss of hope. I ask for strength of life, length of days." To the parent with a wayward child, Lord, I thank you, and insert his or her name here. I thank you that Jill or John is under the watchful care of your Spirit. I entrust my child to you that you will preserve her life, preserve his life until he or she reaches the end of her rope and finds her rest in you. To the faithful witnesser lifting up the salvation of someone who is near to you but far from God, Lord, I thank you for the salvation of my friend, whether she or he be drawn to faith through my witness or through the witness of another. I just want to thank you on the front end. I don't know what the future holds, but I'm trusting. You put her name, you put his name on my heart, and I lift that name up to you in prayer regularly. Now, each of these prayers is what I call a scripted prayer for long-term hopes. Scripted prayer for long-term hopes. A scripted prayer is the kind of prayer you can and should pray every day, often several times in the same day. It's not the vain repetitions that Jesus referenced in the Sermon on the Mount. It is the consistent, persistent prayer of a man or woman, a boy or a girl, who has poured out your soul to God and you just don't know what else to pray. Lord, I've already told you everything I know. I don't know what else to ask. So you script the desire of your heart, as did the widow. Her scripted prayer, avenge me of mine adversary. And you bring it to the Lord day after day after day in steadfast confidence and trust that the God of the universe both hears and cares for you and for your prayer. I mentioned too, I can give you many illustrations, but years ago I came across this idea of scripted prayer for long-term hopes. Brother Dean mentioned that I invited him to come for revival. I happen to remember the date very clearly, March 1995, and here's why I remember it so clearly. On that Friday night before the revival began on Sunday, my dad had no ID on him. My dad had become a wayward man. He was no longer the man I knew. He had a series of strokes in 1988, 90, 91, 93. And my dad was a different man. On that Friday in March of 95, he had a paralyzing stroke. No ID. He was admitted as a John Doe to the hospital in Louisville. Took the social worker 36 hours to figure out who he was and finally got to where he could respond by blinking his eyes to, does the first letter of your first name begin with A? No. B? No. C? No. And she finally had concluded his name was Roger Oldham. Started calling Oldhams in the Louisville phone book. How many of y'all remember when we used to have phone books? Found a relative. She called my uncle. My uncle called me. 6 o'clock on Sunday morning, we're starting revival at 8:30, revival services. So at 8 o'clock, I'm in the parking lot waiting for Brother Dean to show up. When he got there, I walked over and tapped on his window. I said, Brother Dean, welcome. I'm leaving. I said, Elwood and Mike and Jeff, they'll be in charge of all the services. But I just got word at 6 this morning, my dad is in the hospital, paralyzing stroke. No ID, nothing. I need to go up and be there and check on him. And within 3 days, we moved him to Martin, Tennessee, into a skilled nursing facility. And I was there for the end of the revival, taking care of all that in Louisville and getting back to Martin. But 4 years before that, I was walking down Hawks Road in Martin, right outside of Martin, near where I lived, and I'd go walk in the country, and I'd walk 3 or 4 miles, talk out loud to the Lord, and I was walking and talking, just saying, Lord, I mean, it's been 3 weeks now with my dad, and I'm ready for you to fix him. I'm ready for you to change and bring him back. And a big combine was going down the road. It's totally immaterial, except it's just the recollection. This combine, and I had to step down into the ditch in the weeds there on the side of the road for that combine to go by. And as the combine went by, I just ended up standing there, I don't know, 30 minutes or more. But it was like the Lord gave me this insight. The Lord said, son, it's just been 3 weeks. My time is not your time. The day with the Lord is 1,000 years. 1,000 years is a day. My time's not your time. Your time is your time. I said, well, Lord, I've prayed everything I know to pray. And I've tried everything I can try. And it was as if the Lord said to me, and He didn't speak out loud, but I was talking out loud, but it was as if He said, "Son, if you've prayed everything you know to pray, just tell me what it is you want." The Lord gave me a 3-point prayer, and I wrote it down. It's like the Lord said, just pray that every day. And the 3-point prayers all dealt with where my dad had gotten into. I mean, he just, crazy years. That's enough. But the third part of the prayer, that as the Lord allowed Samson to have usefulness for the kingdom one more time before he died, that the Lord would allow my dad to have usefulness for the kingdom one more time before he died. And I prayed that prayer from 1991 through 2001. Every day. Well, in late 2000, my dad wrote a little card all over Martin, Tennessee. Y'all might, if you went over to Martin during that time, you probably saw this guy in a 3-wheeled cart sort of hunking over like this, and he could only use his left hand on the trigger, and had a little flag up in the back, and had a Bible verse on the front that he put after a while. At first, he said, "I'm a fool for Christ. Whose fool are you?" That was the sign on his cart. But Dad wasn't living for the Lord. But he began coming to church. And in 2000, during the invitation one day, I heard the cart motor. And I looked, and Dad was coming down the aisle to the front. And he said, "Son, I need to rededicate my life to Christ." And being the spiritual giant that I was like, okay. Yeah. You see, I've only been praying for this, but I'm like Rhoda at the door when they were praying for Peter to be released from jail. And Peter was miraculously released, and he came and knocked on the door. And Rhoda runs back in and says, "Peter's at the door." They said, "Well, it can't be Peter. He's in jail. It must be a ghost." That's sort of where I was. Okay. All right. Well, my middle sister had told Dad that if she ever moved back up to North Central Kentucky where he was from, that she would move him closer to home before he died. And so on August the 1st of 2000, I moved my dad up to North Central Kentucky. About a month later, maybe 6 weeks later, my sister called with tears. She said, "Sing, what is that prayer you've been praying for Dad, that last part?" And I told her. She said, "Let me tell you what's happened. I don't know what's happened. But Sheldon," her husband is a pastor, "Sheldon has baptized 4 people this month that Dad led to faith in Christ in the rehab room where he is up here." Well, I had to see it for myself, so I drove up there, 375 miles one way. I drove up there, and I got there and walked in his rehab room. And while I'm in there for those few hours, 4 people came into the room. 2 of them were nursing home staff that were off duty, but had driven to come in to tell Dad what God was doing in the life of some people they had asked him to pray for. And I'm like, what is this? As time unfolded, I began to realize God never did not hear my prayer. Amen. Do you hear? I know it's awkward with all the knots in there, but God never did not hear my prayer. He heard it. And just like the widow, you see it? And that became a scripted prayer. I have some other scripted prayer illustrations I could give. I'm only going to give one other. 2.5 years ago, my wife was diagnosed with a very rare artery wall disease, and one of the doctors we saw, he just basically said, "There's nothing to do, there's no treatment, there's no medicine. Go home, take a baby aspirin, hope for the best." That'll encourage your heart, amen. We got to see another doctor who's a specialist in this particular area, and again, she didn't give us any hope, except she gave us hope. She's a vibrant believer. She's from Korea. She's listening to my wife's arteries. And she said, "You are such a musical person." Took her stethoscope. "Would you like to listen?" And Debbie's like, "Sing." At that point, she maybe went a little bit too far. But she said, "We don't know what God has in store." And so I wrote down this scripted prayer for my wife. Dear Lord, today I ask for strength of life and length of days. This day. And for 2.5 years, I've been praying for my wife, strength of life, length of days. We just had our 7th grandson a month ago, I mentioned. My daughter had some serious complications back in the hospital. Do you know who took care of that newborn infant for the first 3 weeks of his life? A woman whose stamina has been sapped, and yet strength of life, length of days. Now, we don't know how long it's going to be. I'm praying that when she's 90 like her mom, my kids will be visiting her like we visit her mom, and she'll be reminiscing about when Sing used to be alive. We don't know, do we? But we know that God hears and God answers. Scripted prayer for long-term needs. It's right out here, right here in our text. I mean, we read it just a moment ago. And you saw it in our passage, the widow coming again and again and again. Let me tell you, some days you're going to pray with intensity and heavy-heartedness. And other days you're going to pray with the pause of unrealized expectation. Lord, I thought by now you would have done something. But quiet confidence in the Father, I'm going to keep on coming. Some days you'll pray with doubt that your prayer will ever make any difference. But because it is the scripted prayer of your heart, birthed out of a deep longing and trust in God, your prayers ascend to heaven. And I use the illustration, I walk every month, I walk about 100 miles a month. I just do that for exercise, but also when I walk, I talk. I talk to the Lord. It's my best prayer time is talking with the Lord while I walk. I want to tell you, some days when I get up, I don't want to walk. I just don't want to walk. And I go out in that first quarter mile is the hardest quarter of a mile because it's down to the creek out from our house and then it's all uphill. Actually, it's about a third of a mile. And by the time I get up to that, I'm thinking, why did I do this today? But somewhere about the half mile to mile mark, the endorphins begin to kick in. And as the endorphins kick in, some days I might end up walking for 6 miles. Because I'm in the zone. And you know, prayer is like that. We think, well, I'll pray when I feel like it. No, you don't pray when you feel like it. You pray because there's birthed in your heart this scripted prayer, I must come to God and I must tell Him what is on my heart when I feel like it and when I don't feel like it. And as I step into that, it's like the spiritual endorphins begin to kick in. And before long, you've spent time with the Heavenly Father who has been longing all along for you to come and simply enjoy His presence. Just as the widow did not give up in prayer, neither should we. British poet Alfred Tennyson wrote these words, "More things are wrought by prayer than this world dreams of. Wherefore," he wrote, "let thy voice rise like a fountain for me day and night." And then he said, "For what are men better than sheep or goats that nourish a blind life within the brain if, knowing God, we do not lift up hands of prayer both for ourselves and for those that call us friend?" Scripted prayer for long-term hopes. Let me give you a second passage of Scripture, Lamentations 3. We saw in Hebrews 11 the description of hope. Here's a progression of hope. You see, we feed our hope by spending time in the Word. Here's some great soul food to return to again and again. This is good soul food, by the way. It's better than jambalaya. I've heard jambalaya called soul food. This is better than that. Jeremiah lived at a time when his beloved city had been under siege by an invading army for 2 years. Food was scarce, water a precious commodity. People were dying daily. Fireballs had been catapulted over the walls, had exploded all over the city, leaving death and destruction in their wake. And as he looked at the empty eyes of his fellow countrymen and women, he saw the emptiness of fear and despair. And in that context, he wrote these words that we sang about a few moments ago. But I want you to see the full context. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 18 is on the screen. I said, "My strength and my hope have perished from the Lord." Have you been there? But he continues to pray, remember my affliction in roaming, the wormwood and the gall. My soul still remembers and sinks within me. But verse 21, this I recall to my mind, therefore I have hope. And then verses 22 and 23, these are on my mom's tombstone. She was hit by a car and killed in 1995. But on her tombstone, these words, it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. And say that last part with me. Great is your faithfulness. And look at the very next verse. The Lord is my portion, says my soul, therefore I hope. Do you see the progression? Verse 18, I have no hope. Now he's reflecting upon God's goodness. Therefore, I have hope in him. In verse 25, the Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. And then verse 26, it is good that one should hope and wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. Do you see the progression of hope? The description of hope, Hebrews 11, the progression of hope. Lamentations 3, I want to give you a prescription for hope. When we find our souls cast down, look up. Listen to these four passages from Psalms. And I love the King James poetry in these verses. Psalm 42:5, why art thou cast down, O my soul? Why art thou disquieted within me? Hope thou in God. Now the New King James here, hope in God. But I like that, hope thou in God. For I shall yet praise him who is the health of my countenance and my God. Psalm 42:11, why art thou cast down, O my soul? Why art thou disquieted within me? Hope thou in God. Psalm 43:5, why art thou cast down, O my soul? Why art thou disquieted within me? Hope in God. And then Psalm 38:15, for in thee, O Lord, do I hope. Thou wilt hear. You will hear. Do you hear it? We ought always to pray and not lose hope. Not lose heart. I chose as my title, Walking in Hope Daily. Now you see why, right? Walking in Hope Daily. In terms of the setting, this parable teaches us to persevere not just when the sin-darkened world is closing in around us. And by the way, has it not closed in around us in 2020 and 2021? But in any dark season we face in our walk with Christ. How many of us have faced our own dark seasons of the soul? How many are in one right now? How many of you found yourselves moving into and out of a dark season with some regularity, especially during this dark season of COVID-19? The words of hope are as needed for us today as modern day disciples as they were for those first century followers of Christ when the darkness of our world surrounds us. Notice again the grammar and language of verse 3 of our text. There was a widow in that city, and she came, literally kept coming, kept coming, kept coming. Scripted prayer for long-term needs. Are you lifting up prayers, long-term prayers for a family member in crisis or dysfunctionality? Don't lose hope. You lifting up long-term prayers for a family member with major illness or spiritual need? Don't lose hope. Are you lifting up a long-term prayer for a lost person on your prayer list, a person who is near to you but far from God? Don't lose hope. Are you lifting up long-term prayer for spiritual awakening in your church, in your community, in our state, across our nation, in our world? Don't lose hope. Whatever your situation, don't lose hope. Whatever your situation, script a prayer. Whatever your situation, pray with intensity or even without. And whatever your situation, pray and don't lose hope. Of course, this passage was written to the disciples of Christ. It was written to those who are believers. It begins with knowing that Jesus is your Lord, that God is your Father. It was written for those who have been saved from the penalty of their sin, have been adopted into the family of God. So I ask the question this morning, are you a believer in Jesus? Are you a follower of Christ? Are you a Christian? If not, the Lord invites you today to Himself. Listen again to Luke 11:13. If you, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him? And you come to Him and say, Lord, I don't have that kind of hope, but I want to trust in Jesus Christ. And I ask the Holy Spirit to come and live in my life and make me a new creation. I want to tell you, He'll do it today. He'll do it today. Don't lose hope. He is able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through Him. And then for those of you who are believers, have you grown weary, finding your hope light growing dim? Hear again this word, shall not God avenge His own elect who cry out day and night to Him? Don't lose hope. Let's say it together. Don't lose hope. Our God remains a very present help in time of need. Let us walk in hope daily. Father, I thank You for the privilege of coming and sharing the Word of God with this congregation. Just looking around, I see so many eyes that are filled with vibrancy, filled with hope, filled with confidence. But in a room this size, I know that there are some who are in the period of despondency, a time of despair, a season of discouragement. And they sort of wonder, does God really care about me? Does God hear my prayers? Let us hear from the mouth of Jesus Himself. We ought always to pray and not lose heart.